It's a wonderful thing, isn't it, when we not only have an intellectual understanding of the gospel, but where we see the evidence for the gospel in the lives of transformed people. And this is what's so convincing, not only the light of God's truth, but the life of Christ manifested in people. And I think of the words the Apostle Paul spoke when he wrote regarding the Thessalonians, and he said, "For from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith towards God has gone out, so that we do not need to say anything, for they themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had to you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come." And so he's saying that your testimony is being borne by your observers, even unbelievers who see the transformation in your life. They're sharing the word. They're talking about it in the marketplace. Have you seen these people? Have you heard these people? And so this is what's so powerful. And there's an interesting book. I've enjoyed reading through it. Some of it's quite heavy. Most of it is apologetic. It was a book edited by Norman Geisler and Paul Hoffman, and various authors in it, people like Gary Habermas, who is a historian expert on the evidence for the resurrection, and William Lane Craig, and so on. Some of the chapters are heavier than others, but there's a fair bit of good in them. But when you come to the very end of the book, before the footnotes or the endnotes, there is an afterword written by Josh McDowell. And Josh tells his own story, how he was converted. But I want to read to you just the last few paragraphs of this story. He's talking about the transformation in his own life and the bad temper that he had and how the Lord changed that. And then he says this: "Perhaps the most significant change has been in the area of hatred and bitterness. I grew up filled with hatred, primarily aimed at one man whom I hated more than anyone else on the face of the earth. I despised everything that this man stood for. I can remember as a young boy lying in bed at night plotting how I could kill this man without being caught by the police. That man was my father. When I was growing up, my father was the town drunk. I hardly ever knew him sober. My friends at school joked about my dad lying in the gutter downtown, making a fool of himself. Their jokes hurt me deeply, but I never let anyone know. I laughed along with them. It was a very secret pain. I would sometimes find my mother in the barn, lying in the manure behind the cows, where my dad had beaten her with a hose until she couldn't get up. My hatred seethed as I vowed to myself, when I'm strong enough, I'm going to kill him. When Dad was drunk and visitors were coming over, I would grab him around the neck, pull him out to the barn, and tie him up. Then I would park his truck behind the silo and tell everyone he'd gone to a meeting so we wouldn't be embarrassed as a family. When I tied up his hands and feet, I looped part of the rope around his neck. I just hoped he would try to get away and choke himself. 2 months before I graduated from high school, I walked into the house after a date to hear my mother sobbing. I ran into her room and she sat up in bed. 'Son, your father has broken my heart,' she said. Then she put her arms around me and pulled me close. 'I've lost the will to live. All I want to do is live until you graduate. Then I want to die.' I graduated 2 months later, and the next Friday, my mother died. I believe she died of a broken heart. I hated my father for that. Had I not left home a few months after the funeral to attend college, I might have killed him. But after I made a decision to place my trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord, the love of God inundated my life. He took my hatred for my father and turned it upside down. 5 months after becoming a Christian, I found myself looking my dad right in the eye and saying, "Dad, I love you." I didn't want to love that man, but I did. God's love had changed my heart. After I transferred to Wheaton University, I was in a serious car accident, the victim of a drunk driver. I was moved home from the hospital to recover, and my father came to see me. Remarkably, he was sober that day. He seemed uneasy, pacing in my room. Then he blurted out, "How can you love a father like me?" I said, "Dad, 6 months ago I hated you. I despised you. But I put my trust in Jesus Christ, received God's forgiveness, and he has changed my life. I can't explain it all, Dad, but God has taken away my hatred for you and replaced it with love." We talked for nearly an hour. Then he said, "Son, if God can do in my life what I've seen him do in yours, then I want to give him the opportunity." He prayed, "God, if you're really God, and Jesus died on the cross to forgive me for what I've done to my family, I need you. If Jesus can do in my life what I've seen him do in the life of my son, then I want to trust him as Savior and Lord." Hearing my dad pray from his heart was one of the greatest joys of my life. Now listen to this. After I trusted Christ, my life was changed in 6 to 18 months. But my father's life was changed right before my eyes. It was as if someone reached down and switched on the light inside him. He touched alcohol only once after that. He got the drink as far as his lips, and that was it. After 40 years of drinking, he didn't need it anymore. 14 months later, he died from complications of his alcoholism. But in that 14-month period, over 100 people in the area around my tiny hometown committed their life to Jesus Christ because of the change they saw in the town drunk, my dad. Josh finishes with these words, "You can laugh at Christianity, you can mock and ridicule it, but it works. If you trust Christ, start watching your attitudes and actions, because Jesus Christ is in the business of changing lives. But Christianity is not something I can shove down your throat or force on you. All I can do is tell you what I've learned and experienced. After that, what you do with Christ is your decision." This is what the world needs to see. Not better arguments, although they're helpful at times, but better Christians. Christians who allow Christ to have his way in our hearts, to transform us, to be like himself, to become Christians in the true sense, little Christs, reflecting his love, his values, his spirit, his truth. And I tell you this, People will trust the Savior when they see lives transformed before their very eyes. May God encourage you to spend a little time with the Lord and say, Lord, do that change in me and make me a billboard to the truth that Jesus saves and satisfies. Mm-hmm.